morning. My name is Yanis Avrisis. We are today in sunny Vienna at IRI, the Institute of Advanced Research in Artificial Intelligence, which I joined recently. And today we are very happy to welcome Professor Pietro Perona. He's a professor of electrical engineering and computational and neural systems in Caltech Institute of Technology, in California Institute of Technology. He's the director of the Caltech Computational Vision Group, and his research focuses on computational aspects of vision and learning. He is known for the anisotropic diffusion equation, a partial differential equation that filters image noise while preserving region boundaries. In the early 2000s, he pioneered the study of visual categorization. He's the recipient of a number of prizes and awards, including the Longwood Higgins Prize, the Kindering Prize, and the PAMI Distinguished Researcher Award for Fundamental Contributions in Computer Vision. So today, Professor Perona will present his work, a number sense, as an emergent property of the manipulating brain. So welcome.
Thank you. So good morning, everyone. I'm glad to be here. And thank you for inviting me to the Institute, whose existence I didn't know until he invited me. And so it's probably good that I can be here today. So I've been, as you can see, I'm quite old. I've been around for a while. I started working in computer vision in the 80s. Before deep networks. And so some of you don't remember a world before deep networks. And so I want to give you a little bit of a perspective before I start my talk. And so I thought I would start with a little preamble. Very simple. So when I started off, we thought we would design artificial intelligence systems by handcrafting them through engineering principles, like you would design a bridge or a house or an electronic circuit in which you know what are the principles that lead to certain behaviors, and you design them in and you analyze the performance of a system and you adjust parameters in a very rational way like all engineers do. And you know that now if you approach computer vision or speech understanding, NLP, instead you will take a learning type approach where you're not handcrafting features or mechanisms, and somehow you let the data speak and say what it has to say, and the system designed itself, right? And so it's wonderful. And so since about 2000, we could see in computer vision that this is the way it would go. And then with deep learning, things have started working very well. Now, there is a little dirty secret. So, you know, the mantra is we let the data speak and the data trains our systems. In truth, there are many people trying things out behind the scenes, about 10 to the 4. So it's not really that the data says there is a Brownian motion in there, which we need to come to terms. I'll put a fig leaf on that for the moment. This is not the topic of today, but since here you're in an institute looking at the foundations of machine learning, this is exactly what you're doing. You're trying to understand how to take this Brownian motion out of a picture and let really the data speak. So today was, to come here, I walked through this wonderful park, and I forget the name of the park. And something I could do with my phone was take a picture of a bird I saw, and then use iNaturalist, which is an app that my students and I built, or we didn't build the app because the app belongs to the California Academy of Sciences, but we built a computer vision system behind iNaturalist. And this computer vision system can recognize plants and animals from photographs. And there are right now about 50,000 species. So when we started off, it was about 1,000, and then it keeps growing. And it grows because people interact with the system and upload photographs and say what species they think they saw. And the system is learning online, almost online, what the crowd is thinking. And then I can go to a park in Vienna, take a photograph of a bird, and it tells me which bird it is from the photograph. So this is something we have today, which I couldn't even dream of when I was a graduate student, that this could happen. And And so I encourage you to download iNaturalist, this app, on your smartphone, and you will be pleased. You will see that it's quite remarkable in its ability to recognize plants and animals from photographs. And the same is true for sounds. And so this again is this morning in the park. And this is work by my former student, Grant Van Horn, who is now a scientist at the Cornell Lab of Ornithology. And so I could turn my app on, and this is Merlin Bird ID. And during lunch, I'll be able to help you download it to your phone. And you can go to the park, and at some point, I could recognize three birds, and at some other point, two more. And it's just a pleasure to learn from our phone what is it that we are seeing. And this is all thanks to machine learning. And so isn't that wonderful? So the way this came about in my career, in my lifetime, was through three big trends that happened. So one was neuroscience in the 60s, the work of Hubel and Wiesel and other physiologists who understood how the brain treats visual signals and auditory signals. And this gave birth to deep networks in the 80s. And so when I was a grad student, deep networks were there and people were using them. It's just that we couldn't train them. We didn't have big enough data sets and big enough computers. So those are the other two ingredients. Moore's Law and lots of kids playing video games that gave us GPUs. And so now we can, and now applications in AI have taken over the development of GPUs beyond what kids with video games do as a market. And the third one is large, well-annotated data sets. And so that was made possible by the internet, the fact that Google could index lots of pictures online. And I'm talking about pictures all the time because that's my field, vision. And then the emergence of Amazon Mechanical Turk in 2005 that allows us to annotate very large data sets. And so in 2000, we started publishing data sets of images with annotations, and we were in the hundreds, thousands of images annotated. I would hire Caltech students to annotate images. And an example is Caltech 101, which was the first large-ish, well-annotated data set in computer vision, which my student Fei-Fei Li did at the time. And then, as you know, Fei-Fei continued, and she put out ImageNet. And so ImageNet is a spark that somehow ignited the deep network revolution, because at that point, people could train deep networks, which had been around for a while, and they could see that deep networks could do real work. And so that was the moment, the great realization. And so everything is really wonderful. And and I'm always surprised when I test online systems. This is Clarify, done by Matt Seiler. And it gives you tags associated to images, and look how accurate it is. If you take these images, it knows that cow is the first, the most relevant label. So, and it's almost any image, it works well. So isn't it wonderful? But since I know how these things are built, I know how to make them fail. And so this is, I can systematically make them fail. And so what's going on here? Can people tell me why is Clarify failing in these pictures? Yes.
Context is wrong.
Right. You're absolutely right. So the context is unusual. And so you can search for cow on the beach on Google, and you feed it into the system, and if the system is not so happy any longer, right? If you look at it from the point of view of a human, this is ridiculous, that it would make these mistakes. And so we have at the same time a funny situation. These machine learning systems like iNaturalist can recognize accurately 50,000 different species of plants and animals, which is way beyond what any naturalist would be able to do. And even on the raw accuracy, they are better than the experts. So we know it from 2017, there are a number of papers that have shown in dermatology, a paper from Google and Stanford, in birds, a paper from us, and so on, that a well-trained machine learning system that does computer vision can beat experts at their own game. And so on the one side, machines have become better than human experts. On the other side, it's so easy to make them fail. So what is the disconnect? And so this is something that people in theoretical or foundational machine learning should start thinking about. And so what's happening is the following. This is a slide I made from data from my student, Sara Biri, who is interested in applications of computer vision to conservation. And here she trained a system to recognize species of animals from camera traps that are deployed throughout California. And as you can see, the error rate that the system makes in recognizing the species of an animal that is captured automatically by a camera trap can get really low to 1% or so, but it takes about 10 to the 4 images. So for species where we have enough training images, the system can get better than a human. But unfortunately, when the number of training example is low, then the error rate is high. And humans may not be as good as a machine when n goes to infinity, where n is a training set, but are far better than a machine when n goes to zero. And this, so as people look at the foundations of machine learning, I think you should keep this picture in mind as a challenge for you. What do we do when the number n goes to zero? And unfortunately, number n goes to zero more often than not. So something I realized, which I should have known from the beginning, is the following. So in our work to collect well-annotated data sets for computer vision, we always try to even out the number of training examples for all the different categories that we were training on. So if you look at ImageNet, at least the version that people use, it's 1,000 image each for 1,000 categories. It's about 1 million images, right? And so we put out a data set called COCO in 2016 maybe. Again, we tried to go to 10,000 training images. We wanted to see how, you know, how far can you push the recognition of objects in complex scenes. But we had to reduce the number of categories down to about 100 because we could not get enough training images for complex scenes for all of the categories we're interested in if we wanted to reach 10,000. And then somehow the brick hit my head in working with birds. I realized the world is a giant long tail distribution. We have a lot of images for very few categories. So you have lots of images of bald eagles and pigeons, but you have very few images precisely for the birds that people don't know how to recognize where the machine should help them. And so the challenge really is training machines with long tail distributions of training examples where some categories are highly represented, but most have very few training examples. And I want to point out to you that this is a log-log scale of error rates versus training examples. And it turns out empirically, if you plot error rates versus number of training examples in log-log scale, you get these beautiful straight regression lines right now. And so my mission is to lower the line. And so the question is, how do we go beyond our training sets and how do we train on things we've not seen when n goes to zero? And unfortunately, current technology in deep networks is all about interpolation. And so I have to learn every single species, every single category the hard way. I have to get lots of training examples because if a bird, I've only seen it upright and one day it's hanging upside down from a tree, well, I will not recognize it. Or if one day it is in an unusual environment, I will not recognize it. And so how do we do that? And so this was a long preamble to my talk today, where what I look at is something completely useless, which is the emergence of numbers. Well, it's not useless because it's an interesting question in cognitive science. But what I'm interested in today is the question of how can we get something out of nothing? How do we get categories and concepts without any supervision? Okay, this is something that probably many of you are thinking about. So to give credit where credit is due, this study was promoted by COVID. I was working with my student Nihar Kondapaneni on the question of how mice learn complex tasks. And he had trained some mice in the lab, and then COVID hit and we couldn't go to the lab any longer for about a year, so 9 months. And so we started working on something different. And this is what came out of this period. So I want to take you back 50,000 years to this bone, which was collected in the south of France. And there are some markings on the bone. And people believe, paleontologists, paleoanthropologists believe that these markings have to do with numbers. And so if you read the original paper, there are a number of converging lines of evidence, which I'm not going to cover for you because I want to talk about something else. The idea here is something like this. And here I go a little bit by my imagination. You can imagine a small clan of humans, maybe 15 or 20. And they're living in the south of France and they live in a cave. And they're out foraging and hunting. In the evening, they have to come back. And so the matriarch of the group is standing in front of a cave and it's getting dark and she keeps her thumbnail on the notches of the bone. And as people file in, she can count them and know that everybody's back. Something like that I have in mind. And so here you have a version of numbers that is not terribly sophisticated. So it doesn't include summation and or subtraction. It just includes putting one-to-one in correspondence a set of people with a set of notches on a bone, but it gives you the beginning of a sense of counting. And so we're very familiar with natural numbers. And mathematicians have argued forever on the foundation of, you know, what defines natural numbers. And currently, you know, for the last 100 years or so, we know that the right way to think about it is putting sets, elements of sets in one-to-one correspondence. And so you get an equivalence class between sets, and this equivalence class defines numbers. The property that makes two sets be equivalent is exactly the number of objects in the set. And that's how people think about the natural numbers. And then there is structure on top of that, which is ordering, and then you can go on and add sum and subtraction and all of that. Okay, so these are the numbers and we have them in our head. And so the question is, how do they come up in our head? And you say, well, you know, we go to the kindergarten and they teach us to count, and that's how they come up. And so today I want to explore something a little bit more adventurous, which is maybe natural numbers can come up in our heads without the need of a teacher, at least at the level of concepts, not at the level of naming them, because naming is a convention that has to be taught, right? But at the level of category. And so I want to take you through the steps through which this may happen. So there are two currents in cognitive science on thinking about numbers. And the most obvious one is the numbers are an outgrowth of language. So why would you ever think that? Well, it's very simple. So there is this this abstraction that language makes in which you assign names to symbols and things. And there are these correspondences of abstract notions with real things. There is ordering, counting seems to be very linguistic. There is a notation going with it. So it feels very much like an outgrowth of language. But there is a different perception of, or a different idea on how the numbers may come up, which has to do with perception. And so if I asked, some of you, so if I could ask you, how many birds do you see? Six. Okay. And how many bison do you see? One. Okay. So I think all of you had the following impression. For the bison, it's immediate to know that it's one. You don't have to count bison. But for the birds, you're not sure if it's five, six, or seven, and you've got to count them to some extent. Is this correct? Yeah, I can see people nodding. Okay. So, but you were never mistaken thinking that there might be 100 birds or two. So you knew it was in the order of magnitude of six, seven, five, whatever. And then you had to count to be really sure. So here you see two perceptual facts, two properties of your visual system. One is called numerosity estimation. And so when I see a number of objects in the tens, 7, 10, 20, 100, and so on, I have a sense for how many they are, roughly within 20%. And I can see it quickly with my visual system. And so that's called numerosity estimation. Now, when the number is 5 or less, something else kicks in, and it's called subitization, and it's ability to tell at a glance the number. So if I have three objects, like three keys on a desk, or two pen, or four pens there, and so on, I see right away the number, right? So the subitization, it's immediate. Okay, now another test. And so I'll show you a picture, and I'll ask you quickly to tell me, so you tell me quickly at roughly, you know, what is it? And so here, more than 10? How many? 15? Give or take, yeah. So you're all roughly right. I think it's 17 or 18, something like that, depending on whether you count the ones that you see completely or not. So it meant incomplete. Now, this fact was discovered 150 years ago by somebody called Jevons, who is the father of modern economics, the person who thought that economics had a mathematical foundation. And so one day he was playing with little grains of rice or paper balls, I forget which, on his desk, and he realized he could tell the number immediately if there were few, but he would have to guess if there were many. And so he published this table. In the meanwhile, if you have any questions.
I have a question. I guess the number 5 is very much related to the number of fingers we have at our hand, because we all basically grow up with seeing 5 fingers all the time.
Yes.
So 5 is a very, let's say, natural number. Also, everybody of us has 2 ears. So I think 1, 2, and 5 must be very natural, let's say, in that respect.
Okay, that's very nice. Yeah.
Well, I would propose that this could be tested, because there are people that have 6 fingers. It's actually a dominant mutation.
Okay. Yes.
So a while ago, I attended a conference about anthropology, and there it was stated that we usually are able to count immediately up to 8, because that's the number of an ancient family. So that's what was immediately in our mind when we had to count our next nearest of kin. Whether that explains it, I don't know, but this is at least what I heard in the past.
Interesting.
Yeah. If it is indeed up to the amount of fingers, then I'm surprised that the machine learning algorithm from the paper has a very similar number to humans, even though it hasn't seen that. But it was pre-trained on AlexNet, so that could have something to do with it.
Okay. Very interesting. So as you will see, the algorithm I propose comes up with subitization up to 6 for some reason, but not 5. So I don't think it's magic, but... you guys have a point. It's very interesting. So again, it's language or perception. And certainly perception is an important part of it. And one way to prove it is here. And this is work by David Burr, who is a very smart psychophysicist and psychologist. And here is the idea. Does any one of you know about the waterfall illusion? It's something that people study in vision, visual psychology. Okay, so you're on a hike and you come to a beautiful waterfall. If you fixate a waterfall for a minute, you just keep looking, and then you move your gaze to the rocks or the trees that are on the side, you see the rocks and the trees going up, okay? So you see motion, even if there is no motion. Why is it so? Well, because the way the visual system is built is motion is the result of a push-pull configuration of two mechanisms that are sensitive to motion in one direction and the other. And the visual system has to keep rebalancing itself and zeroing itself out. And so if you keep fixating something that moves, that becomes a steady state, and then the push-pull mechanism is taken off balance, okay? So this concept is called habituation by psychologists, and you can see it whenever you access some of the primary functions of the visual system, okay? So what David Burr and John Ross were able to show is that that numerosity estimation is subject to habituation. And so the way you do it is the following. First of all, let's look down here. You make subjects fixate across, and then you come up, you present patterns of dots, and you ask subjects to tell you which side had more dots. Okay, very simple. Now, suppose that we have one side always the same number of dots, well, at random, and the other side has either fewer or more, and you count how often subjects tell you that the other side has more, you can draw a curve such as this one. It's called a psychometric curve, where here you have the number of dots that you're comparing with. Here is the probe, namely the fixed number of dots. In this case, it was 30. And so what you see that if the number of dots is 10, 15, and so on, people say that there are fewer on the side that you test. And then if you have more than 40, then it's reliably people say that 40 is more than 30. Okay, very simple. Now here comes the clever bit. When you show the cross where people have to fixate before the pattern comes on, you can present a pattern already, and that's the habituation pattern. And if you present this habituation pattern and then you test, and then you have an unrelated number of dots come up afterwards, it turns out that humans will underestimate the number of dots on the side that was habituated, okay? And you see it from this other psychometric curve, which is shifted to the right. So you need more dots on the habituated side to create a sense of proportion or equality with the other side. Okay, so this is clear. And so what John Ross and David Burr showed is that the process in your head that estimates quantities doesn't go through counting, you know, of some sort or the other. It's truly something that is highly, how could we say, fit forward in a visual system, and it can be habituated away. So today we take the point of view that perception plays a big role. And what we want to know is we start with the first question, are natural numbers then innate in a sense that a visual system gives them to us? And it turns out that if you look at the literature, Elizabeth Spelke is the most prominent scholar in this, and they show that babies can indeed have a sense of quantity, but it's not very good at all. It's like a factor of two, and it only works with few objects, but it doesn't work well with many. They respond to patterns with lots of objects, but not with patterns with few and so on. It's very limited. So it's certainly not innate. It's something that you have to develop. And so the question is, how does it develop? And there is work in this domain using deep networks. Somebody called Stoyanov and Zorzi in the University of Padua a few years ago had a clever idea. Maybe we can take autoencoders, and if we ask people to look at patterns of objects, and there is an autoencoder in the brain, maybe the representation in the middle will be something like the natural numbers. And so that they were very interested in this question. And so this is a paper, a picture from their paper that shows you the bottom part of the autoencoder. And so this is not done on people, it's done on an autoencoder in a machine. And so they showed patterns like these to the autoencoder and asked the autoencoder to reproduce the same images as they saw. And so if you look at their paper, this is what you get. So this would be the input, and this is the output in their autoencoder. And any one of you would be able to implement this in 1 hour while having lunch. I mean, if you look at the paper, it's very elementary. and what you find is that, and so I don't want to go through the details, but the the point is that you do find in the hidden layer of the autoencoder, the constricted part, you find units that tend to be tuned roughly to the number of objects. And the number of these units is decreases in as a function of the number, but they're there. And then you find another paper from okay, I'm blanking out on the name, somebody in Germany, but where they did something even simpler, or simpler, if you will. They trained a regular, it was not a ResNet, it was an AlexNet, I think. They trained it on ImageNet to recognize objects. And then they tested it using patterns like these. So the network has never seen these patterns before. It has only seen real images, and it has been trained to classify ImageNet categories, so about 1,000. And then you can test it with patterns containing dots. The dots may have different sizes and shapes and so on, so that you control for the effect of pixel density and all of that. And you do find inside the network, you find units that are tuned to quantity. And so you find units inside the network that may respond more to around 3 objects, and some units that may respond more to around 20 objects and so on. Yes.
May I just ask, so this is not a network that was trained to segment these pictures on the right. This is a standard classifier.
Yes.
That's an AlexNet
trained on ImageNet. And then they look at units inside the network. And in some of the intermediate to later layers, you do find units that are tuned to quantity, to number. Okay, there is one more paper from a Korean team that came out last year that finds this property in a randomly connected network before any training. So in some sense, the idea that you find in a randomly connected network or trained network or whatever, you find units that are tuned to roughly quantity. As you can see, the tuning is not very good, but they are somewhat tuned. It turns out that you find them out of the randomness of how networks are connected, okay? So this shows you that the network is will contain units that are somewhat tuned to quantity, and then it should be possible to discover those units through a classifier that uses some limited supervision. So you use some supervision to recruit those units that are tuned to quantity, and then it gives you estimation. So this seems to be one way to go about it. And so you can see that the network almost wants to count, but still supervision is needed, right? And so the question we're asking is, do you need supervision or not? And so the point of view we took was, well, maybe some of us have children. And so we see, this is one of my sons a few years ago. And the children are always engaged in exploration. So what is going on in there? And might the actual undirected exploration or play be something that helps the network come up with abstract concepts? And in this case, we focus on numbers. And so the concept is this one. So this is me playing with tomatoes. And again, the idea is that the child would spend hours, and those of you who have little children, so you see them, they take Legos or they take acorns and they put them and place them and move them and so on. And they look at what happens. And so is this enough for training a network to do the right thing? And so in order to formalize all of this, this is the point of view we take. There are 3 actions. So if you imagine the child is able to pick and place objects, like very early around age 2 or so, they develop this pincer grip in which they can pick up an object one by itself and place it wherever they want. And so their motor system is able to execute a take operation. So from the workspace, they take something out, or a put operation from they put something into the workspace, or they can I call it shake, they can perturb the order and look at what happens, okay? So the point of view we take is, the child is playing, it has three primitive operations, putting an object, taking an object. You could think of putting any number of objects at once, and what I'm saying it carries through, or just scrambling things around. And while the motor system is playing, the visual system is being trained. And maybe that's what generates the perception of numbers. And so how does it happen? I'll come to that point. And so our goal fundamentally is the following. So we have different scenes where the number is the same, but visually they're very different. And ideally you would like them to be mapped to a same concept. And you would like this concept to be distinct from the concept that corresponds to scenes that might be similar, but contain a different number of objects. Okay, so you want something like this to happen. So how do we think it happens? And so again, repeating the same thing as before, you would think that there is some embedding where perception maps any image it sees. And so it maps it into some abstract space. And in this abstract space, things that are similar number-wise should be mapped to a similar point. And things that are different number-wise should be mapped to different points. Yes?
Sorry. I get the concept of the numbers and the tomatoes, but what I also see in those pictures are lines which are parallel. And what my kid would say is those two tomatoes down there are on the same track compared to the two tomatoes up in the middle. I know this is just for visual representation here and not for the computer to learn, but yes. I mean, like, it just, you know.
Okay, got you. So, yes, that's another very salient property, which I had never thought about. I'm glad you pointed out. Let's talk about this over lunch, because I have some idea, and this is very interesting. But I'm not going to be able to, my talk will not address that question at all. Now, once these categories are made, then you can associate names for the categories, and that's not what I'm talking about. I'm just talking about the emergence of the categories. So how would we go about it? And so, okay, we know about supervised learning. We were talking about it before, and we know how it works. So we have a desired label that has to emerge, and we compare the desired label with what the system is producing, and if the system produced the wrong output, then we have to update our embedding and our classifier, right? That's what it works. So how do we train a system for subitization? And so if we did have available to us the category that we want to produce, then of course we could use supervised learning, but that's a point, we don't have it and want to see if that emerges in some way. So clearly we cannot use this point of view. Now, what is it that the system knows about? And so now you have to think about the system in two different ways. One is perception. And so perception is being taught by the motor system that about three things that the motor system knows, namely put, take, and shake. These are the three things that the motor system is doing. And since it's part of the same child, it's able to communicate to the visual system, look, I just put an object there, what do you see, right? So the visual system is supervised by the motor system, and the motor system knows three things, which are put, take, and shake. Now, if you take the system overall, namely the child who is engaged in play, there is no supervision whatever, but the motor system is pre-trained. It doesn't know about numbers, but it knows about motions, about picking and placing. So, so in principle, we could try to supervise our system with those actions and see if an embedding emerges that tells us something about numbers. However, there is something wrong with this picture. Anyone can point it out to me?
There is no ground truth.
Okay, there is no ground truth, but the the motor system gives a ground truth because it knows if it's putting, taking, or shaking.
Okay. Would you need a second picture?
Exactly, so thank you. So a single picture makes no sense because we don't know if it's a picture before or after, right? So we need to do two pictures. So this doesn't work either. We have to do something better. And now by now, you know what better means. We have to have some Siamese type configuration in which we look at the picture before, the picture after. We have some short-term memory. So if we produce a representation with the picture before, a representation with the picture after, and then we compare, and then we can tell if it was a put, take, or shake. And so we can try this and see if it's any helpful. So this is another representation of what I'm talking about. So now, instead of it going from left to right, it goes from the bottom to the top. I have the world where I have an action taking place. And the motor system knows what's the action. And now we produce two representations, the one before and the one after. We can compare them and guess what the action was. And now we can get supervision. Okay, so that's the idea. And the way we implement it in practice is probably not as good as what you would do in your lunch break, but and it's just some three layers of CNN, a couple of layers of fully connected network, and another couple of layers fully connected network up there for comparing. Okay, very simple. And here this network is reproduced twice, but it's the same network which trains from the same signals, right? Any questions on this? I think that this is a slide in which none of you needs clarifications. Okay. And we do the same disappointing thing that people do in psychology, namely we use artificial images which we generate. And the reason is it's so much quicker than me standing there with tomatoes and acorns and so on. But of course, that would be more fun. And so we used a number of different statistics for our patterns. The simplest one is that we use squares which are always the same size. And they vary in number, and they vary in position. And so here we have a shake, a put, a take, and so on. But then you also want to explore what goes on if you make it a little bit more complicated. And so here you have each dot can vary from time to time in size and in contrast. And so this mirrors a little bit the tomato situation in which if I move them around, one of them may go into a shadow or may present a different angle. And so they may look different from time to time. I cannot count on persistence of appearance from one image to the next, okay? And then there are more experiments we've done with adding noise and so on, but here I will, and so all the results I show you have to do with this second pattern that I show here. So let's train the network and let's see what happens. And so first of all, I want to look at the performance of this classifier, which is the supervised part. And something absolutely unremarkable happens, which is here. So here we have taken the network you saw, and we've trained it with patterns from 0 to 3 objects. So we were not generating more than 4 objects per scene, more than 3, and never going below 0, of course. And what happens is what we expected all along, which is when you test the network, if the number of objects is within the realm of the sets that you use for training, then the error rate in classifying the three actions of take, shake, and put is very low, about 1% or 0.3% or something like that. As soon as the number of objects goes beyond the training set, then the error rate climbs until it reaches 30%, which is what you would expect, 60%, which is what you would expect if you had random guessing, okay? Very simple. These are the two, so it's called model one, model two. These are the two types of data that I showed you. And so the more difficult one is the orange one, the one with varying contrast and size, and you see the errors are a bit higher, okay? Very simple. So as for all deep networks that we know about in a supervised setting, it can be trained well within the realm of the training set, but it doesn't generalize to new situations very well at all. And so when we test with too many objects, things go south, okay? And let me skip this. Now, the first surprise comes when we look at what happens when we change the size, the dimensionality of the embedding. And so there is 1 degree of freedom in the model I showed you. How many dimensions should the embedding have? And so what you see is that the error rate, this one, the within sample error rate, the error rate when the test set is within the number of objects we trained with, the error rate doesn't change as you change the dimensionality of the embedding from 2^8 all the way down to 2^0, namely dimension 1. Okay, so this is the first big surprise, which is the embedding doesn't seem to matter. The dimension of the embedding doesn't seem to matter, which is a bit surprising. And so this should start giving you some ideas what may be happening. Now, the interesting part goes when we look at the embedding itself to see what happens there. And so we've seen what happens with the classifier. And now we go and we see what happens with the representation. And so this is the representation. So we take an embedding that we've trained with 2 dimensions. Why 2? Well, because it's more than 1, so it's more interesting. And it's within the realm that we can display on a flat screen. And so here, Nihar has tested the system by presenting images with a number of objects up to 30. Okay, so we trained up to 3, and here it's tested up to 30. And he has color coded, so each dot here is an image mapped to the embedding. And as you can see, the color code is graded, but the first salient fact is that the embedding is so singular. It's like a line, like a fat line, but it's a line. So instead of using up all the dimensions available, which is what we're used to in embeddings, in which the more dimensions we provide, the more the embedding is happy to use the space. Here, the embedding is not trying to use up all the space. In fact, it's just constraining itself to a straight line. So the second salient fact I mentioned already, and it's that you see that there is a smooth color gradation, like there is an ordering of the quantities. The third, you have to squint a bit, but I've enlarged it here. It's a smooth line, but it has this property of flaking out at one end. And so if you zoom in, you see that even here there are islands, and they're not visible because the dimension of the dots is too big. But when you go in, you see that there are these islands. Now, we know that the brain is pretty good at unsupervised clustering. So we are very good clusterers. So if you use an unsupervised clustering algorithm, you can discover how many islands that are hidden in there. So what is the natural number of the sets that you find. And here in this case, you find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 sets in there. And so you wonder what do they correspond to? And they correspond to the natural numbers. And so this is how we see it. if I have an image with 0 items, it will map to the first cluster, A0. One item, they will all go to the second cluster and none beyond. 2 items to the third clusters and so on, up to 5 or 6, beyond which it becomes a continuum. So it looks like the system has discovered the natural number 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then many. And then it has this continuum later. Now, this also gives the system a property of subitization, because not only it has discovered these categories, but since it can map instantly any image into one of those abstract categories, it can now subitize a little bit better than a human, so it can go up to 6 instead of 5 like a human. And then beyond that, it's many. Now, the question is, so subitization is one thing we wanted to explain. The other one is whether we can estimate quantity. And so how would the system estimate quantity? Well, we've seen that these points are ordered smoothly by how many objects there are in the different images. And so if you imagine that the system has discovered this category, so this category of zero is very special because the cluster is tiny. The world always looks the same when you have no objects. And so you could imagine the system thinks of this as the origin. And then these items are spaced evenly, so it can get a unit of measurement from the spacing. And so it can estimate, it can count just by knowing how many units of measurement an image is along this line. And so you can do that and you discover the following. These are different patterns produced by our random pattern generator. We feed them into the system and we see how they compare to a reference pattern. And so this would be 16 objects. And so typically 12 comes out as smaller number. So this is, you know, how many there are more or less in the comparison. And 20 tends to come out as more. And in between, there is a bit of ambiguity. And it can also do absolute judgment in a way I told you before, namely comparing, looking at the distance from the origin, and you get a slight underestimation of the number of objects in the pattern. So red would be a correct estimation where this is the ground truth, this is the estimate, and the system tends to underestimate a bit, okay? Now for reference, this green halo is how different human subjects would estimate, okay? So it's within the realm of what humans would do, and humans also tend to underestimate a little bit. Okay, so you've got the main story, which is yes, the system can train itself and it can discover this property of natural numbers, and it can train itself to subitize and to estimate numerosity. And how do we know that it's truly counting? Well, so maybe the system is just looking at how many pixels are non-black, right? Or maybe it's looking at the envelope of the size of the envelope of the objects on the display and so on. Now we can test for that because the patterns we generate are random. And so there are instances where properties that would be spurious correlations go counter tendency with respect to the number. So in this case, intensity, here we have a case of 14 objects where the intensity is higher than 16 and 18 objects. And area of the non-black pixels, here there are more non-black pixels than there. And the convex hull is bigger here with fewer objects than here with more objects and so on. And so you can look for patterns where spurious properties, whichever come to mind, are going against are not supporting the number. And you can look at the error rate that the system makes, or the accuracy of the system as a function of those spurious dimensions. And what you see is that there is no effect whatever, namely it's the number that carries the day. Okay, so I can go in detail if you want, but it's pretty obvious. Okay, one last thing. So one prediction you could make is, well, a child with no hands should be retarded in their number sense. And I looked online for papers that study children with no hands, but I couldn't find any. But I found a paper by Manuela Piazza here in Trento, where they look at children who have a motor disorder where their hands are shaking. They are not well coordinated. And you do find the retardation in the development of the number sense. And so if you look at the paper, you know there are lots of things that they study in the paper, but you do find overall a retardation. And so is this a correlation or a causation? I don't know, but it's interesting. Okay, last slide. We seem to be right on time. Okay, the first is I told you about the number sense, and I showed you that it can be learned without an external teacher. And the way that this works is, in this case, manipulation is teaching perception. And so you assume that the child is able to pick and place objects, which doesn't mean that the child knows about numbers, but by playing, the child will acquire this abstraction, at least according to our model. And this is a model, it's not reality. Now, the model accounts for phenomena that psychologists think are different, namely subitization and numerosity estimation. And so from the psychology point of view, this may be interesting because it provides a framework in which to think about both things at once. And from the point of view of people who are interested in machine learning, this is a case where machine learning extrapolates from something that is known to something that is unknown. And so I'm wondering now, if I go back to computer vision, if there is any way to use this type of reasoning for teaching computer vision systems to do a little bit more, like introducing manipulation maybe, or introducing other sensory modalities and making them work together and see if we can go beyond the training set. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Questions?
Yes.
Very general question. So the put and take, I understand them as addition and subtraction, if it's only in maths terms. Have you thought about trying to add and take maybe two objects or perform a nonlinear operation like a multiplication so that the number of objects in the picture is always multiplied with itself? So squared-like operations, whether you still get a line or whether the line represents one, four, and so on.
Thank you. So for the first, so the second question, no, we have not tried. The first question, yes. So somebody asked us, and an undergraduate student in the lab tried, what if you cannot control how many objects you're adding or taking out? What if the child hasn't developed the pincer grip, but they're just grabbing three objects at a time, putting them in, and so on? The system is working still, and I don't have a slide for that. Now, let me see if I have a slide that addresses, I don't seem to have it. Maybe, let me see. Yeah, so I don't have a slide that shows that for counting up and down, the system has a map between the different number concepts, at least from 0 to 8 or 7 or whatever comes out. So it knows how to come up and go down. And so there is a notion of counting. And we have an idea on how to extend the results to summation and subtraction, but I've not showed it here. So, but multiplication, no, I don't, I wouldn't know how to handle that. Thank you.
So first of all, thank you. It was a great talk. And I actually have 3 questions, so I hope it don't take up too much time. First of all, what do you think is the significance of having used AlexNets? Like, I think if I recall correctly, you use pre-trained AlexNet, right?
Yes. Yeah, so we assume that it doesn't matter, that AlexNet is not crucial. But your question makes me think that maybe we should have a control and use ResNet or something. What would you use?
Yeah, I'm not sure, but I wonder whether any pre-training is necessary at all with simple images like that. But...
Yeah. Yeah, but we have not tried with different deep nets. Yeah.
Okay. Then a second question would be, do you have an explanation as to why, even though there is an abstraction and generalization to numbers of objects that have not been seen in the training data, like you can predict up to 30 items, right? Why can it not do the action prediction?
Yeah, so we don't know. I'm myself intrigued by that. And so, any answer I give you would be sort of confabulation, which you're able to do yourself. So I don't know. I don't have a good answer. So one thing we looked at a little bit is, as you can see, that the line and the embedding is a bit thick. And so what happens when you move side by side? And And so there is the impression is that the configuration of the dots, as you might imagine on the image, makes it move it side by side and also up and down a little bit. And so if a dot slowly leaves the scene, then you have a dot that moves to the next number of objects. And so the periphery is a little bit less sensitive than the center, if you will, as you would imagine, right? So there is some wrapping of this topological discontinuity into a continuum. Yeah.
Okay. So then for the third question, maybe I'm not familiar enough with the literature here, but you call it unsupervised learning, right? I would call it self-supervised learning. Do you know the difference here? Does it make sense to use this terminology?
Yeah, I mean, this is purely, what happens is pretty clear. Okay, usually people use the term self-supervised when the information is in the signal itself. Like if you take images and you train a classifier or some inference network to predict what the green channel would look like if you only show the red and the blue channels. And so this in sub-supervision, the signal is intrinsic to the stimuli, the data points. And here it's outside the data points because it's from the motor system, but yet from the system's point of view, it's self-contained. And so it's a little bit difficult to name it, but we know what's happening, yeah.
Okay, I see.
So third question.
Yeah, maybe a small remark here because you mentioned the paper that shows that random initialized networks already have some neurons that correspond with numbers, right?
Yeah.
Maybe this relates to this whole lottery tickets thing. Maybe you are aware of the paper where networks start out with neurons that correspond to the task to be learned, and then they downscale everything else during learning. But I'm not sure how relevant this still is, but thank you for your answers.
Yeah, I would be interested in talking about it. I don't know the lottery tickets paper, so I would love to hear about it during lunch. Yeah, thank you.
Just a follow-up question to this one. So have you, maybe I missed that, have you checked along the diagonal whether basically the mean location of a number, whether the distance changes, so from 0 to 1 and so on and so on, that they are basically positioned more close to each other? Not sure whether I explained well.
Yeah, we saw that in one plot, and so I want to go back to it because I didn't spend much time on it. Here. And so if you take the distance between 0 and 1 as your unit, which is here, as you go along the line, there is this underestimation, which means that when you have 30 points, the network will think that there are 27. And then you have a bit of variance, so between 25 and 28, yeah. If you will. And so as you go on, there's a bit of a compression.
So would that explain that you still have the diagonal, but you wrongly predict the operation? Could that be related?
Yeah, I don't see that relationship, but maybe at lunch you will explain to me why.
I have to think about it as well. It is just
It's interesting. I would love to love to think about it. Yes.
Yeah, the question is as well regarding unsupervised. To me, the idea that you track in which state you are. So if you put something in there, you move to the next state.
Yes.
And if you subtract, you get back. That's unsupervised, but isn't like the magic in exploiting this knowledge? And there you get the signal from...
That's right. So the network bootstraps itself. So there is a sense, there are three actions, one of which doesn't change the number. One, it increases it, and one, it decreases it. This is fundamentally what it is. Now, this is a supervisory signal. And so the supervisory signal is not sufficient to induce necessarily numbers or quantity, but it has some value.
And you wouldn't have some kind of incentive to think about it. You have to be like, it must be useful, or you must be curious, something like that.
Exactly. So to me, okay, again, I'm talking about the child as a metaphor, but truly I'm interested in the machine learning aspect. And so what I see is the value of play. And here play is one system, namely the motor system, challenging another system, which is a visual system, to do something useful, like tell me what I've just done. Now, the fact that we have these three actions and one of them adds, one subtracts, and one doesn't do anything is important. Now, the system has to figure out what they mean, right? The system is not told that one will not change a number and one will, and the other two will in a certain way, in a certain other way. It has to figure it out, right? So it's not an explicit mapping between these actions and increasing, decreasing, and not changing. That has to be figured out by the system. But evidently, it's an easy task for the system.
But like as a child, you don't have a goal. You just play. And why do you do it? So is it useful to know that if I have three, I can give away three of this kind? Is this something that helps us?
Right. So, you know, here, yeah. I mean, what this tells me is, the principle seems to be that we want to have multiple systems, maybe even if you take just vision, multiple visual tasks, like stereoscopic perception and visual recognition or something like that. But you want to have multiple systems that do different tasks, trying to find relationships with each other's work. And ideally, we would be able to not to have to put that in explicitly, but we should let the systems figure it out by themselves in some ways, which seems to be the
exactly.
crucial
but
aspect.
Compared to nature, we have to think about an incentive for the system to actually start doing it, right?
Yes. Yeah, so we have, so I'll tell you about some other project we have, which I'm happy to talk about at lunchtime, which is, I'm working with a colleague called Markus Meister on how mice learn complex tasks. And we release mice in a maze. The maze is complex. It's a binary maze. Think of a binary tree with six levels. So there are 64 leaves to the tree. And so in the maze, the mice go around. And in one of the leaves, there is a reward. There is some water. The maze is the mice are slightly thirsty. And so they start exploring, and they find the water, and they drink. And then they remember what they've done in a way that is surprisingly fast, so much faster than you would expect with reinforcement learning. And so that's a crucial thing of the experiment. But then we see that even if the mice are not rewarded, namely they are perfectly fed, they are not thirsty, they still engage in exploration. So we realize later that the reward was not necessary at all. And that's what they do all the time. They want to keep exploring. And even once they've mapped out a maze in a way that allows them to navigate at will between different places, they will still go and check as if there was a possibility that the world has changed in the meanwhile and they want to re-verify. So there is this drive that you could call playfulness or curiosity that is fundamental, I think, to learning, and that maybe machine learning we're not exploiting enough.
Thank you. On that topic, I think it relates heavily with reinforcement learning curiosity, where you try to predict the next thing that is going to happen, and if your prediction is off, you get reward until you have learned how things work. And then you move on to the next thing that you can't predict, right?
That's right. So
I have one more question related to the figure you have shown us at the beginning with the data, where we see that you have basically one object, then you put, and then you have two objects.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, the mice. Now we need to look at it, but let's look at the mice first.
So this is the maze in which they come in. So their house is here, there is a pipe, and they come in whenever they want. They stay in this little house for a night. And this is the number of times the mouse has been in the maze so far. Initially, they just stick their nose in and they go out, but they become more courageous And at some point...
Could it be that the mouse also smells? Like, have you corrected for that?
Yeah. So we've done a lot of controls and it doesn't seem to be the case. Okay. So the water is here. And at some point it would find it. But as you can see, that's, so it turns out that all of this exploration is not, so I have to go to here maybe when at some point it would find the water. It turns out that all of the exploration you see is not driven by necessity. It's just driven, okay, here it would find the water, boom. Now it drinks, now it tries to find. So then we give it a 90-second timeout. But basically, and so from this point on, it's able to execute straight paths. That is over time. And so when it wants to get water, it goes directly, and it learns it immediately. Sorry, so I this is just for people who are interested in curiosity. Sorry, so you had a question?
Yeah, do you mind going back to the figure you showed us at the beginning where we see two line of pictures, I think.
When we see...
it's basically figure two in your paper. No, not this one.
Oh, yeah. Okay. So is it this one?
No, it's further back. Yes, this one. Exactly. So what I see is from the first row, I shake, I understand. Then I put, but at the same time, there was a shaking, right? So how
yes.
is this?
Okay, so we, okay, thank you. So we discussed this a lot, and so I'm curious to see how people feel about it in this room. So first of all, one thing we realize is even when you simplify things down to the bone, like here, you still have many degrees of freedom to what experiments you could be doing. And so there are, when you do a put, you may decide to leave this where it was and just add one more, right? And and then you worry that if you do that experiment, then the system will learn to do background subtraction and just do something silly like that. And when I was playing with tomatoes, I realized it was very difficult for me to keep them always in the same place. Let's see. Because they're round and they bounce around. Okay, this one has stayed there. As you can see, when I move my hand, the shadows also change their position. Anyway, so I decided that it was more general to let them move. Now it turns out that if you let them move, you're not helping the network because you're not allowing it to do background subtraction, but you're helping it on the other hand because you're helping it generalize better to know that two things. And so we have now experiments where we titrate this notion of how far can an object go from one setting to the next. And that helps, but it's not fundamental. And now we didn't want to burn the paper with a million control experiments, as you might imagine, but it's a very good question, you know, how does that help or hinder the system?
I just have a few questions related to the intro where you showed how systems are doing worse when they haven't seen things. So I was wondering if you ever only showed the system, say, odd numbers, or even numbers, would it fill in? Or if you only showed it numbers larger than 10, if you only showed it things larger than 10, would it extrapolate down to smaller numbers?
Oh, I see. Okay, I don't know. That's a nice question. Okay. It's funny because we're preparing a version for a journal now.
Yeah.
And that may be an interesting, yet another variation on the theme, you know.
One thing I'm sure you thought about a lot, but which really spooks me at the moment, you showed at the beginning that in random untrained networks, you also have these number properties. And I'm just wondering, I guess you've compared the performance of your trained network with untrained or so.
Yeah, no, it's not comparable because while here you have some units that show tuning, the tuning is loose, and also most units are not tuned to numbers.
Okay.
So although if you look with a searchlight, you find these units, unless you have supervised learning, these networks should not be able to count or do subitization.
Okay.
And so it's two different worlds. This is still in the world of supervised learning, and what we're interested in is how unsupervised can you be somehow.
Okay, thank you.
One last question. Is it that, have you tried in the end more encodings than just two dimensions for this intermediate representation? Because in my opinion, having just only two dimensions could theoretically restrict, so to say, the network to just to use them in on the line as we did, simply because the objective is symmetric, right? It's like put is the opposite of take. So you want to represent this on the time axis. And I think this could break up when you have three dimensions already. So I think this would be the most important innovation, in my opinion.
Okay, so first of all, we don't see, as we change the dimensionality of the embedding, we don't see a change in the performance for the train task, which is the action specification. Okay, so yes. And so we find still the linear arrangement. Now, the question is, when you project it down to two dimensions and you look at it, it's linear, but maybe it would be a funky shape if we look at more dimensions. And so we have developed a method for fitting a line in n dimensions and seeing how far does it go from that line. And in the current version of a paper, it's not the one in archive, we have a few plots. And basically what happens is in 90%, it could be 85 or 95, I forget, in the vast majority, maybe 95% of the experiments, it's truly a line where it's like what you saw. And there are a few cases where the line has a kink at some point, like a 15 degree angle. And I wouldn't know what to say, but but it doesn't do what you're worried about. Yeah. Yes.
On a related note of the previous question, that the network would also extrapolate counting downwards, I'd be very interested in having it seen negative numbers, but if it is able to extrapolate to negative numbers. Because when you learn in elementary school, you are restricted to positive numbers because you count on your fingers. And then at some point, the teacher tells you that there are actually negative numbers and the principles are actually the same. So I would be very curious to see how this works out.
I see. Yes. I have to ask Nihar, because Nihar, my student, who went off on a different project for a while, now he's back on this project because we want to send it to a journal. Anyway, so I want to do that experiment and see what happens. And so let's see. So you guys suggest that we should train with between 10 and 13 or something like that, or 8 and 12, and see what the embedding looks like. It's a very nice idea. I'll see that it's done soon. Yeah.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
So we have people watching remotely, and they said it's one of the best talks so far.
Thank you
very much for the talk, and they have a number of questions here. So one says, I read about savants having very high subitization limits. How would you explain how their brain is able to count large numbers up to 100 immediately?
I don't have I see. So the savants can, okay, there are some tricks. And so I would love to see a paper about this. I can tell you, I don't know what's the name of the remote person, I can tell you something I saw. There was, someone in the US was showing that QR codes, these square patterns with dots. So somebody was able to spot, so they would be shown two QR codes. which only had one dot difference between them. And so you have them side by side, and the savant, alleged, could tell right away, okay, this is different, very quickly. And then there was a trick. And what this person was able to do was to stereofuse the two patterns. And then it would correspond apart from one dot, which would appear like a fuzzy spot on the pattern. And then boom, they could tell what it was. So there was a trick. So when people tell me about savants, I say, well, you know, let's have a psychologist do a little bit of an investigation and see what are the cues that they're using, because the patterns may be quite revealing in ways that we don't expect. And then the savant has figured out how to exploit a small difference. Yeah. A small cue that is there, we don't know about.
Thank you. So next question is, how would you explain why the Siamese networks are able to embed something as complicated as numerosity, but the classifier is unable to simply subtract the two embeddings and determine the size, the sign of the result? So I guess this is referring to having
okay.
The inputs, the two images.
Yeah, that's very true. Okay, so here is what I think is happening. Okay, thank you for the question. It's really perceptive. Here I think what's happening, and we have to go to a pattern we saw before. To this one. So as you can see, if I go to 20 objects, there is a variance in the estimation of the number. And so what you can imagine is that within the number line that we saw, there is a variability in the position on the line. And since in classifying put, take, and shake, we rely on differences of one number only, maybe that's too exquisite a difference to resolve, and maybe that's a problem. Now that I'm saying this, I'm thinking that down here, the variance is so small that it shouldn't matter. And so what we should see is good performance in classifying put, take, and shake down here in the early numbers, like 6. And let's go back and let's see what happens. So at 6, the error rate is maybe 20%, which is far better than 60%, which is what random chance would be. And so maybe it's not so surprising, but I confess that we should look at it a little bit more carefully to know what's going on. Okay, hope that my answer is 70% satisfactory, but may not nail it down.
Right. Okay, so another question is about accounting neurons. How do you think about accounting neurons in random neural networks? When training, do they lose their counting ability in new counting neurons emerge? Or is their presence necessary?
Oh, I see. So the question is, since the paper by Kim shows that they're there in an untrained network, what happens if we track? So if we track this specific unit, which seems to be tuned to 10, if we track its tuning while it's being trained to recognize ImageNet, to classify ImageNet, would the tuning go away and maybe some other unit becomes tuned to number? And we haven't done it, and I've not seen it in any paper, but it's of course an interesting question.
I have a related question. At some point, you discussed about the design of your system, and you pointed out the alternative of having labels on the number of objects, but then you excluded this alternative. And you
the naming.
For the put, shake, etc. So,
right.
So why couldn't we have like targets for the numbers to count directly?
Okay, so you would say, okay, let's see if I got your question. So you're saying as a child develops, and again, we're thinking about children as a metaphor, but as a child develops, develops, they are told sometimes the number of some objects. So they do get a little bit of supervision. Mm-hmm. So why wouldn't you use that supervision? And so what if in our setup, every 10,000 examples, there was one in which we had supervision and we just tell the system, okay, this is two, how much would the system be better or how much faster would it be trained? Okay, that's a good question and we haven't looked at that.
It would be like training directly a counting neuron for the number of objects.
So right. And so how much faster and better would it be? And I don't know, yeah,
okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Another related question, LSTMs have been observed. We have neurons in the memory block that count, for example, characters in a line, or store whether quotation marks are open or when they close.
Uh-huh.
So do you consider the counting as a byproduct of the architecture of the network?
Okay, so yeah, so we have seen people use LSTMs for counting. So there is a line in the psychology literature where people are looking at number sense over time. And so if somebody knocks on the door three times, you also know it's three knocks, right? But if they knock seven times, you wouldn't. So you have the same phenomena that I talked about of subitization and numerosity estimation in time having to do with sounds or even touch. So I should, so it's good that this question comes about because I hadn't made it clear. And all of these seems to be related in psychology literature, although here we don't, of course, we don't explore that. Now, if you go over time, indeed, people would use a transformer or an LSTM network, and inside the network, then you can look for units that are tuned to counting. And so would you get the same abstractions? I would say so. Now, would the abstractions be the result of the architecture you've used? And again, I would say, you know, to some extent, if you use the completely wrong architecture, nothing comes out, you know, garbage in, garbage out. But I would say that over a broad range of networks, maybe LSTMs and transformers, you should see the same phenomena that we saw here, I'm guessing. So I would say, no, it's not a property of the architecture. It seems to be more of a property of how you train it.
Mm-hmm. So there is a comment here from Sepp Hochreiter.
Yes.
He says LSTM, an LSTM can learn to count to one or two easily, but fails for higher numbers as the differences become smaller.
Uh-huh.
First objectness, then abstraction, then counting.
Okay, thank you, Sepp. Thank you.
So I also have a question related to architecture. So considering the architecture of a convolutional neural network, I guess we will get like feature tensors with some special resolution up to some layer, and then there is some pooling or some fully connected layer that gets it down to a vector. Mm-hmm. So my question is, have you tried to visualize the feature maps in the convolutional layers? Because I imagine there could be like an easy a kind of computation to solve this task. Like you could detect small dots for every object present, and then you could just sum the activations to get the number. So the network can do summation, multiplication,
yes,
and comparisons with these two, three like basic operations.
Yeah.
Maybe it's easy to build accounting systems. So have you tried to explain how it works by visualizing those feature maps?
No, and I'm ashamed of it because I should have. I mean, I envision this is my job and I've not done it. I have, you know, roughly the same intuition that you have, which is the network should reduce each one of these dots, which in our, again, in our hands, they can be quite diverse in appearance, as we see here. So if the network is to be successful, it should be at some level, at some layer, it should be reducing each one of these dots to a dot, of these points to a dot,
mm-hmm,
no matter what its extent and contrast. And so it should become invariant. And then it should just count the dots by summing in some ways, right? That's what you're saying.
Exactly, yes.
And yeah, that's what I would expect. But yes, I blush to say we haven't done that. Thank you.
Thank you. So a question about the Siamese setting. What would it correspond to in the brain? Would the first scene or representation come from memory? Does it need to be an own action to provide the signal trigger for the classification? And more generally, what would be the order of events, scene, feature extraction, classification?
Okay, so I don't know if I understand everything, but so the comparison can happen only once you see the second scene, of course. Mm-hmm. And so you have the second scene and you produce the embedding for the second scene. And the assumption is that the first one is committed to short-term memory, and then you can compare these two signals. One is in memory and one is present in the current scene, and that's what you're doing. I don't know whether this answers the question. I'm just repeating what I said before. Did you see something in the question that went beyond this?
I understand it as having the two images as input concurrently or storing one in memory when you observe the second.
This yeah, so like
how would it be implemented?
We're assuming that it's over time. Although in psychology, they test you with the two images present at the same time, which opens up another interesting question, which we have not addressed, which is, as you fixate in the Burr-Ross experiment, so again, it's something that we should look at. As you fixate in, as you look at the fixation cross and then the two patterns come up, then you have simultaneous presence of two of these patterns in the left and right hemifield, which map to the two hemispheres. And so this would say that you have to have a representation of number simultaneously, one in the left and one in the right hemifield, and then they get compared across the brain in some region. And so now you could say, well, would the experiment still work if the two patterns were above and below, and so not mapped to the two different hemifields, but maybe to the same hemisphere? And that also, I don't know. I've asked David Burr, and he doesn't know either. So the question is, how many of these things can the brain represent at the same time, and how well does it represent them over time, and can it remember it over many presentations and so on? So that's not in the literature. Right. Yeah.
We did this here, Sepp Hochreiter. We did many experiments with counting with LSTM, and we encountered different phases. First of all, which you don't address is objectness. What is object? What's not an object? What objects to count? I think set you left aside. But if you're in the stage where you really are able to count by an LSTM, the problem was whether there's a thing or nothing, it's easily. For also here, what you see with the bees, that's we call it crowding effect. If you have a crowding effect, you have a problem because you cannot distinguish objects from non-objects. That's a separate thing. But what we observed is counting to 1, 2, 3 was easily. A memory cell, you can make a threshold. But then distinguishing between 10, 11, 12, was really, really hard to do, because here you go from a continuous system, from a neural network, into a discrete system, into a symbolic thing. And to do symbolic things was hard. Which works better now is to have somehow like attractor points for 1, 2, 3 things, but to put it out of a memory cell, whether you have stored 3 or 10 things or 11 things, it's hard to define a specific point, and this were points where memory cells converge to something. This solution was much easier. And I think in humans, I think you have something like attractors. You have some symbolic states which represent 2, 3 or something like this, but you do harder for higher numbers. That things we observed. What's your take on this? What's your comment on the thoughts I throw at your head?
Thank you. So first of all, nice meeting you, Sepp.
Nice to meet you.
And And then, so the question is, were you working over time or was it over space? Was it a single image?
We did both, but first over time.
Over time, right? Yes. I think.
But we can also go over space and scan the space, and we also can put in whole images. We did all of those.
Okay. So do you feel that what you found is similar to this difference between subitization and numerosity estimation that psychologists find? Namely,
but feeling is that counting is not a continuous thing like a memory cell increasing, but at some point you go to some fixed point. These are two things. Now you're sure these are two things, or these are five things. Either you see it directly and you're in the fixed point, or you have another process like counting, which is a symbolic process where you get more and more convinced it's like in 21.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Sepp. I think your comments were very clear. And I would say that my intuition is more or less the same as yours. Do you remember roughly when you published these results? How far back?
It's many years ago. Wow.
So if you would, I would. You know, if you could email me a pointer to your papers and make sure I'll take a look before we publish a journal version of this.
Yeah, but a nice thing is because there's a gated recurrent units, they cannot count. Counting is a very specific thing. And whether counting is in the symbolic part or whether counting is still in the continuous part, I'm not sure, but I believe counting goes to symbolic.
Thank you.
Some related question. At one of your slides, you have shown that up to three, there were those three or four or five, there were those islands of points, and then there was a continuum. So I was wondering, if you think about the input image, when the number of objects increases, the resolution of the image stays the same. And the more crowded it gets, the objects are closer to each other, and maybe it's more difficult to discriminate them. So if you tried, let's say, to use a high resolution in the image so that the distance between the objects could be the same as the number increases,
okay,
maybe it could keep having islands for larger numbers. Have you tried any of this?
No, that's a very good question. The details are we settled on a certain size of an image, which may be 100 by 100 pixels or 128 by 128. And because of that, we couldn't go beyond 30 objects for the final experiment, which is fine. But as you say, so what we should do is maybe look at when we have four or five objects by chance, sometimes they may be very close to each other. Would that be a point where the system has trouble resolving them, for example?
Mm-hmm. So it's and, like the boundaries are confused between.
Yeah, I should also mention one more thing, which is as we generated our objects here, we have a rule. So the object can be placed anywhere, but we have a rule that they have to be separated by at least 2 pixels, because otherwise we wouldn't know what is the ground truth any longer. But of course, in testing, you can do whatever you want. And so we should also test when the objects are overlapped to see what happens. And we haven't done it. So yeah, thank you for your question.
Because for humans, of course, it's difficult to count to 100 directly, but a machine maybe can do it.
Yeah.
So one last question from my side. In the ground truth that you used, I look at the two pictures and I don't see necessarily put or get or shake. I see like greater than or less than. So my question is, did you always compare images where the difference is one, or did you try to compare one with three directly, which is still greater than?
So here, for example, we set a random pattern of 16 as the probe. And then we compared random patterns from 0 to 30. And this line here shows you how often would the network say that the pattern we compared to had more points?
Right, but this is at inference. Did you try something similar at training?
Oh, in training,
like
okay.
Like present one and three together, and three is greater than one.
Okay, so so there is a control. It sounds like all the questions are asking me, 80% we haven't done it, but 20 we have. And so here is one we have done, which is if the child by mistake picks up when they put more than one object.
Exactly.
What happens? Mm-hmm. So in that case, the system is trains well. So when the number of objects put in is random, in a small range, because if you have only three objects, you cannot put four in, the system still works well. It trains, the properties are the same, let's say. So it doesn't matter, yeah.
Thanks. So any other questions here? Okay, no other questions remote either, so thank you very much again. It was an excellent, great talk.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure to hear you today.